So we can start right now, sir.
Will we start?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, last lecture, we were talking about the onboard computers. Are you able to hear? See the slides?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Now, before I start giving this one, I want to know that I have given assignment to students. What happens? Anybody submitted or not yet? Students, already your due date is over. Karthik, are you able to hear anybody?
Yes, sir. Tell me, sir.
No, what happens to that assignment?
Assignment, sir. I had sent them this thing, sir. I'll send a reminder again, sir. Excel sheet, I'll send them to form a team. Yes, sir. I'll get a reminder today, sir. Let's see what.
Okay. So that we have to start now. So let us see. We will be starting again. This, I don't know to what extent I think we have gone through just the basic introduction and certain design considerations. A student can respond up to what we have gone through. Have we discussed design considerations?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And what about this design constants, vibration level? They're all vibration level and everything is given elsewhere. Now, this also I think we have discussed.
Yes,
we were
sir.
Talking about this, I think, chart. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now let us start with this one. And today we will try to complete this onboard computer part. The next class I will take about the reliability aspect. Well, that is also another one module is pending for you. So as I must have mentioned, this development of onboard computer is called as an embedded computing system. So it involves both hardware as well as software. So what is required is that because of the time schedule or in general practice, hardware development first will decide the architecture, then the hardware development will go ahead parallelly with the software development. Now, how somebody will ask question, how you can go ahead with the software development without hardware. So there are a lot of simulators are available on which you can develop your basic codes. And then after the software is developed, tested, and then you can integrate with the hardware system. So in case any software module to be tested with respect to some hardware signal and all those things, that will be evaluated. Otherwise, in the software testing alone, you have to test, simulate the input in software only, and then carry out the testing. Then after this integration, so we have to carry out the batch test. So this is called the integrated testing. Now integrated testing is also is multiple levels. One is in the lab area itself, you integrate and test it. And for this testing purpose, you require a special equipment called the test system for onboard computers and also the load simulators. So those things are specifically designed for individual computers, onboard computers. And with respect to that, you simulate some input, you give this input and then see that output response. Now, how do you know the output response? What should be the output response? So for that purpose, again, I should say at the high level, we develop the complete software in the high level computing system. There, we generate the test cases. Given this test condition, what is the output you observe? Output in terms of wheel speed command, or in terms of thruster output, in terms of torque output, and so on. So once this is called the test cases. So these test cases are generated. And with respect to these test cases, we have to test thoroughly the computing on OVC. So once that testing is over, then we'll put everything will be closed. And then we will go for a thermowork test. So thermo, as earlier also speakers must have told that we have to carry out the thermal test and vibration test. So this is the procedure, thermowork test, where we simulate the environment in terms of the temperature, in terms of the vacuum. Now, obviously, in orbit, there's a vacuum is like zero, but practically it is not possible to simulate that vacuum here. So it is 10 to the power minus 5 bar or minus 6 bar or something, that order we simulate. And that is good enough to test the thing. So once the testing is over, then the package will be subjected to vibration. Now the vibration profile earlier we have discussed, I will just go through. This is like a thermal thing, and this is a specific. Now this again depends upon, like earlier speaker has told, Dr. Nair has told, it is again depending on function of this launch vehicle. So we have to take the specification from the launch vehicle and then subject that specification, map it to, see, launch vehicle give the specification for the entire satellite. Now we are talking only the onboard computing system. That, so we have to translate theoretically from the entire satellite to the where the OBC package is mounted. So that will give the idea that to what level of vibration one has to go through for the integrated testing. So in case any problem at any stage, whether is a thermo vacuum test level or vibration level test level, any observation, one has to review, and then in case is required, it should be corrected. Now the question comes, once there is a problem, we open the package, then correct the error, then once again, we have to, depending upon the amount of correction, one has to again go through this thermowork test and vibration till we get the satisfactory result. Once this is over, then all the documentations are made and the package will be handed over for the spacecraft integration. Then another team of people, they will take care about the operation of this one. Now, at the spacecraft level, we can't test it too much detail. It is mostly like a sort of black box testing. See, as far as our integrated test at the bench level, we go for a white box testing to the extent possible. Whereas at the spacecraft level, we go only the black box testing. So giving input condition, what should be the output? Giving input condition, simulate the conditions, and what should be the output? So those things are tested at the spacecraft level. And moreover, once we are testing, there will be plenty of subsystems in the spacecraft level. Now, at the spacecraft level, one cannot devote enough time to carry out the testing. So this is what the whole development philosophy of onboard computer. Now, there might be some changes with respect to agencies, whether ESA, NASA or something, but overall development strategy remains the same. Okay. Next. Now we'll go into a little bit more detail on the development. So what kind of onboard computers we come across? Okay. You have also seen, one is the prime computer is attitude and orbit control computers, which is required to maintain the satellite attitude and orbit to a desired specifications. And this is gives the diagram, like it is a typical controller. Here, this is a onboard computer. And here, spacecraft dynamics is simulated. And the sensors are mounted on the spacecraft dynamics, giving the value, reference value to the sensor and actual value of the sensor. The difference is given to the computer, that is AOCC means attitude and orbit control computers. Okay. And then based on that, the actuating signal for the actuators are generated, and the actuators are mounted on the spacecraft, and that in turn generate the torque. And because of the torque generated, error will get corrected and again sensed by the sensor and the loop goes. So this is what one carry out the attitude and orbit control computer. Sorry. Okay. Now another kind of computer used are in some of our satellite is phased array antenna. Now there are two type of antenna. I am not going to give too much detail of that. I will not go into that. There are two type of antenna. Suppose I want to point an antenna towards particular direction. One is that physically we have a gimbals and that we can test it. Other is the electronically steer it. So each is some radiating element. So we excite this element, bulk of element. Suppose I excite this kind of elements, then it will point toward this direction. Suppose I excite these elements, it will point to this direction and so on. So this is called electronically steered antenna. So sometimes they call phased array antenna. So this is also require a lot of computational requirements, and some sort of onboard computer is also part of that. Another thing which earlier speaker was talking about the star sensor. See, getting the error computed from earth sensor or sun sensor is comparatively easy. But when you want to improve the accuracy, you might have to go for the star sensor. Now, what it means by star sensor? Star sensor, the reference is taken as a star. Now, since the stars are very, very far, small deviation in the error that can be detected. And hence, it provides a very accurate result in terms of arc second. Correct? Now, someone will ask a question. There are millions of stars in the sky. How can you map it to such kind of thing? So stars are classified in terms of its magnitude. Magnitude means intensity magnitude. Taking sun as a reference, and then sun as a magnitude 1, 2, then 3, 4, different stars. So what one can take as a minimum limit by which the star's magnitude is there, and say then remaining things we can ignore. So the number of stars at any time in the sky of that kind of magnitude, up to that magnitude, will be a limited thing. So one, based on that one, and we store the catalog inside the computer and compare this catalog with the existing one, and then we can compute the attitude error. Of course, this is it's quite complex algorithms, but it is done like this kind of things, and you can get accuracy order of few arcseconds. Okay. Now, as already I explained to you, see here we give as a reference error as a reference. Normally, the reference of our error should be zero, but suppose you want to have bias, then you can give as a bias reference. Then it is applied to a control law, whether it's a PD control law, PDI, PID control, or P control, or depend what kind of control we are using, and that control law is computed inside the onboard computer, and that generates the actuating signal to the actuators, and which is given to the spacecraft dynamics. Now, apart from this actuator, there is already disturbance torques are happening, because if there is no disturbance torque, once you set the spacecraft attitude to the desired one, it will not deviate. But practically, it happens, there are a lot of disturbances. So spacecraft attitude keep on drifting. So because of that, sensor value also will keep on changing. Now, whole purpose of this onboard computer is to maintain the sensor value to the desired reference. If reference is zero, means sensor output should be zero. If reference is something else, then it should be that bias value. So that is what, just 1 minute, please. Hello? Hello? So, sorry. So if depending upon the reference value, one has to carry out correction to that extent. So that is what the job of the onboard computer. Now, if we go more detail on the onboard computer, what we have here is, say this is our onboard computer. Are you able to see my slides?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, this is the onboard computer. Now, we discussed so much that it has to sensor output, actuators, and all those things. So this required to be interfaced with the different kind of sensors, whether it is a sun sensor, whether it is earth sensor, whether it is a, here it is not mentioned as a star sensor, but any type of sensor, or the gyro. So these interfaces have to be provided on the onboard computer. Now, these interfaces are provided along with the gyros. Gyro provides your rate input, whereas this provides the error inputs. And similarly, star sensor also provides the error input. Apart from that, you have also studied that this spacecraft required housekeeping data, means its own health data. So that health data are collected and put into a required format, and those formats are transmitted to the ground as a telemetry stream. And in the ground, once the format is known, you can extract the required data and display in a convenient form, or rather engineering form, so that any engineer, as far as engineers are concerned, scientists are concerned, they will look for the visual values, whatever you want to have in the engineering units. So that is what even can do. Now, many times it so happen that we may have to give a lot of command for the satellite, as we discussed earlier, one of the speakers, the telecommand system. Now, telecommand system for orienting the spacecraft to some direction, or selecting the gain for the controller, or thermal control of the heaters and temperature sensor, and so on. Many, any purpose. So these commands are given to the onboard computer, and after issuing these commands, it provides the required operations. Now, similarly, what we have here is the power system, because this attitude and orbit control computer does not generate the power by itself. It receives the power from the solar panel after the required regulations. Okay, regulators are used. Suppose we are using 5-volt regulators, then it is a 5-volt, or if it is a 9-volt, then 9-volt or plus minus 12-volt, depending upon the kind of hardware what we are going to use in the AOCC. So that is what required. Then another one, if you have seen already the block diagram, this is the actuators. So this is actuators are with respect to wheels. That can be one wheel, that can be three wheel, there can be a four wheel, depending upon the type of configuration, whatever you have. So AOCC has to interface, provide the interface, required number of interfaces to the actuators, like wheels. Similarly, we have several thrusters, 8 thruster, 12 thruster, 16 thruster, depending upon the configuration. So this has to provide the interfaces. Normally, these are not digital signal directly, particular for the thruster. Thruster require a high drive. So there is a driver in between computer and the thruster, but that is embedded inside the onboard computer. Do you understand what I'm talking? Driver. See, current provided on the digital signal will be order of milliampere, but for driving this thruster, I require ampere. So one has to boost the current. And that is what the drivers are. Similarly, there are another kind of actuators, magnetic torquer. There will be magnetic torquer for controlling the satellite attitude using magnetic torquers, and which interacts with the earth magnetic field. Again, here also there could be a one magnetic torquer or multiple magnetic torquer, depending upon the configuration. Again, here also magnetic torquer normally require higher current. So whatever the onboard computer, that provides only the digital signals, and which is again interfaced with the torquer using some of the hardware drivers. So that also is a part of the onboard computers. Now, another unit, of course, there could be, depending upon the configuration, multiple more units, but this is just a representation of what kind of interfaces it has. So it has to be on the payload interface. Now, payload can be camera, payload can be transponder, payload can be anything else. Okay. So whatever the required interfaces are there, so you have to connect to this one. Now, the question comes, normally the life is not so simple. We have to have always be listened to the reliability, and of course, subsequent lecture also you will listen to the reliability aspect. And there will be always redundancies. Means if one item fails, at least you should have a redundant. That is for commercial thing. But many of the university satellite, they can't afford to have redundancies. And you say, their redundancies are not there. In case some component fail, whole satellite itself will fail. Or they provide a limited redundancy for the part where the failure rate is likely to be high. So that one judgment one has to do in the design. But as a basic guidelines, university satellite life is maybe a couple of months or maximum 1 year. Normally people don't provide the redundancy. And you say their idea is, if one satellite fails, within 6 months you can send another satellite. And that is what is happened. But now, with seeing all those things, we'll cover later that it has to provide interface with sensor, it has so many interfaces are provided. Why can't you make a universal interface? That also will cover at the later part. Okay, any doubt here?
No doubt, sir.
Shall we go ahead?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So, I think this somewhere I have mentioned or not, I don't know. Earlier, the microcontroller, the selection criteria. Now, so far we have talked about this philosophy. Whatever it has to be, interfaces and all those things are there. But the prime component here, it is microcontroller, and which is based on that, the onboard computer is designed. So now how to select the microcontroller? So that is where we have a selection criteria. See, first thing is that speed of the controller. So that is measured in terms of flops. Now, how do you know what is the speed is sufficient or not sufficient? So once you know what kind of control algorithms are there, you have to estimate how many flop per second computation is required. Okay, so that is what example I will just give elaborate example. Is this one elaborate it? Suppose I want to compute a equation A equal to B plus C plus D. It is just hypothetical equation. So what, and this particular equation have to be computed, A has to be computed every 10 milliseconds. So you know how many additions are there? Two addition, A plus B plus C. Two addition every 10 milliseconds. So per second you can calculate how many things will come per second? 100 times of that. So that many flop, that is for, you understand how to calculate 10 milliseconds to 1 second?
Yes, sir. 10 power minus 3 into 10.
No. Suppose in 10 milliseconds, I need a 2 computation. Per second, how many computations will be there? I need a simple arithmetic. There is nothing very big here I'm talking. Straightforward. Every 10 millisecond, if I have to compute either two flop floating point operations, how many floating point operations you will require in 1 second? Anybody can answer?
Sir, 10.
Anybody? Are you able to understand the question?
Not exactly, sir. Like for 10 milliseconds, there are 10 flops. So in 1 second, how many flops, sir?
In 10 milliseconds, you require to compute 2 flops. Okay? In 1 second, then how many flops you require to compute? Tell me. No, probably I think if you have not understood, this means something is wrong. Anybody else can answer? Okay, I'm just giving you one example. Taking 10 milliseconds, if in 10 milliseconds you run, say, 1 meter, in 1 second, how many meters you will run? Suppose you are running continuously, and we found that in 10 milliseconds, you are able to run 1 meter. In 1 second, how many meters you will run?
Sir, 100, sir.
So how do you calculate?
Sir, we do ratio proportion.
So, value in 10 milliseconds divided by 10 milliseconds multiplied by 1 second. Correct? So 100 times. Will it come or not?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, this is all primary school questions. They are nothing very specific. I ask you very specific way. So similar way, we have to compute the flops. So for one equation, how we have to collect, like how many equations are there? how many multiplication, how many division, how many additions, subtraction, and so many collect, and at what rate we are computing. Means how many computation at every 10 millisecond or 20 millisecond, then you translate that one to per second, and that will give the required flops. And over that, you give enough margin, at least 1:2 margin. And such kind of processors, 1:2 select. Now the question comes, when you are going for commercial satellite, you have a very limited choice because of the higher level component requirement, radiation hardened component requirement, and so on. But normally university satellite, they are not radar component because the cost of component will be exorbitantly high. A controller which you can go to the market and purchase in 100 rupees, it will cost for the radar processor, it may cost around $10,000, that order of magnitude. So the cost difference is very high, and that's why in university kind of environment, people don't go for such kind of thing, because here the life of the satellite is limited. If it there are good chances that it will survive for 6 months, and then you can, your objective is fulfilled. Now another one important part is that the microcontroller or microprocessor, they are classified in terms of the word length, 8-bit, 16-bit, 32-bit, 64-bit, and so on. How do you select a particular word length? Whether I should select 8-bit, certainly 8-bit will be cheaper, then 16-bit, then 32-bit, and 64-bit. Now, where is the target? How much we should select? So this again depends upon how do you select. We simulate the complete algorithms or computations inside the computer, and then we limit those computation to 8-bit length and see the results are acceptable or not. Because many times if the computation is not accurate, the result will diverge. Simply it will go exponentially diverge. You will not able to beat. So we have to find out 8-bit or 16-bit or 32-bit. So that, based on that, we have to select the microcontroller, that which word length microcontroller you should use. Third item, as we mentioned, of the design constraint, there is a power constraint. So you can't select a controller which consume very high power. But nowadays, most of these controllers are CMOS controllers. They correspondingly, their power is less. But here, again, though the processor capability is more, from power point of view, if a controller runs at 10 megahertz, lower end only I am talking, or let us say a controller runs at 1 gigahertz, it meets your requirement. But if I run at 100 megahertz, then also it meets your requirement, means you have enough margin available, then what speed you would prefer to run? Can anybody run, sir?
Sir, 100 megahertz.
Why?
Sir, because it is cheaper and also, like, you can save a lot of money and it will save a lot of...
Controller is same. The same controller is available. You have selected the controller, and if I run at 1 gigahertz, it does the job. But if I run the same thing at 100 megahertz, also does the job. You have selected, happens to select whatever the available controller, such that even 100 megahertz, it does the work. Then what happens inside the, those who have studied the digital hardware and so on, the power consumption also proportional to the speed of the operations. Higher the speed, higher will be the power consumption. So if I can manage my work at 100 megahertz, I will not prefer to work at gigahertz. So that is the primary reason. For the same controller, if I am able to run at the lower frequency, that will be better. So we have to optimize the power consumption. Okay. Now next. Now most of the time it so happen that we select the microcontroller or microprocessor. I hope you people are aware of the difference between the microcontroller and the microprocessor. Microprocessor is a CPU, just processing unit, and microcontroller adds lot of peripheral to the CPU that include IOs, ADCs, and some DMA controller, interrupt controller, and so many things. So here particular what we have to see, some of the requirement for this microcontroller is some of the sensor and temperature sensor, you have to monitor analog, how many analog channels we require. If a similar microcontroller, one provide 10 channel, other provide 16 channel, your requirement is 14 channel. So you will select the second microcontroller. So that helps in reducing the overall hardware, because these analog channels, if you require externally, then you have to put ADC, you have to put multiplexer and so on, complication. But if it is there as a part of the microcontroller, then that hardware is saved. Understand? So that is where one has to select a controller such that number of analog channels are as per the requirement. In case no microcontroller is available, meets the requirement, then anyway you don't have choice. You may have to put external hardware. But our effort should be how to minimize the hardware. Similarly, for the digital I/O, many of the nowadays controllers are available, they provide a lot of digital I/O. But still, we have to estimate how many I/Os we need, digital I/O, and then you have to select a suitable microcontroller so that it meets the requirement. If none of them are available which meets the requirement, then you have to extend this I/O. That means you require additional hardware. So that is where we have to have a controller which can satisfy IOs, both analog and digital I/O, to the extent possible. Now another criteria for selection of this thing, the RAM. In earlier days, random access memory, which is store the temporary data like computational data, used to be outside the microprocessor. But now many of these microcontroller, they have a built-in RAM. Some are 256, some are 512, some are more, maybe more also. Okay, so you have to select such that you can meet your requirement, so you don't have to put external RAM to the microcontroller. External RAM means, though, if you put external RAM means you require a lot of hardware. Similarly, the program memory. Nowadays, many of this microcontroller, they have a built-in program memories, particular E-square PROM. But specific to university satellite, you can go for the E-square PROM. But however, because of the reliability considerations, people will not allow you to go for E-square PROM in the commercial satellite. Okay, because comparatively the reliability is poorer for this E-square PROM, or they are susceptible to a lot of electrical noise and so on. But however, now that E-square PROMs are also quality is improving, many of the people are considering to go for the E-square PROM base. If you go for E-square PROM base microcontroller, then it saves quite a lot of hardware. So that is what is one thing one has to see. Now another important part, if I was just mentioning to you, there are so many type of interfaces are required. Some are required digital, some are analog, some are other particular specific, and so on. So nowadays there is a tendency that we should have a specified interface to the extent possible. like primarily that onboard serial interfaces are like SPI bus, I2C bus, RS-232, RS-232 people don't use now, RS-422, RS-485, MIL-1553 or so many things. In our ISRO satellite, earlier we were not having any bus. Then slowly we have introduced some simple buses. Then further, we have introduced, nowadays most of our ISRO satellite, they are based on MIL-1553 serial bus. And that is the de facto standard for all military applications. So that is where one can go for that. But of course, in these buses, one has to design bus configuration properly so that the communication takes place at the required rate. Okay, so that is what is very, very important part of the interface. Then, university satellite, you can take a risk, as I mentioned to you. But for the commercial satellite, people do not take such kind of risk. They can take the controller or the processor, which is already flight proven. Now, question comes, somebody has to fly first, then only he can say flight proven. Otherwise, how it is a flight proven? So for that purpose, many times different philosophies are used. Suppose in a system, one can fly apart from the normal computer, additional as a piggyback payload and see its performance. That is one aspect. Other way of checking is, as I mentioned, a commercial satellite, there will be always redundancy in the system. One system is made with the computer, which is already well proven. Other chain we can make using this one, depending upon the amount of risk you want to take it. So that is where the question comes, that how to prove its heritage. So that one can go for that, such kind of thing. Then, see, onboard computer require a very large amount of the software. Now, going software like a conventional mean, manual driven and all those things, it takes enormous amount of time. So there are standard tools are available, cache tools and compilers and required IDT or something, you know, development environment, IDE, integrated development environment. So suppose if I have a choice of the controller, which meets all my previous, all these requirements, then we would select a controller for which a rich tool in the sense they can provide us a faster development of the software. Okay, such controller will be selected. So that is where is very, very important. Of course, when we say tools are available means they are not like just like that you can download from internet. They are required to be a certified tool, particular for commercial. University satellite is different. There are many norms are violated. But for the commercial or the scientific satellite or for normal satellites, we require a certified tools which is available for that. Apart from that, these are the things are there. Some cases we may require special peripherals. Okay, that also one should evaluate what kind of peripherals do you need for such application. Of course, this problem nowadays getting simplified. One can use, if it is a digital peripheral, one can simulate that peripheral inside one FPGA. So if you select field programmable gate array, FPGA means field programmable gate arrays. If you select such that, you can simulate those peripherals inside that FPGA. So that may be sufficient for your application. So these are the criteria. It's not too much exhausted, but these are the some of the important criteria used for selecting a microcontroller. If you have selected a wrong microcontroller and later stage you find that if you have selected a microcontroller, at the later stage you find it is not able to perform all your tasks within the given time, then what will happen? You have to select another one. Either you accept the degraded performance or you then redesign everything and then carry out the work, which means the overhead on this development time schedule will be very, very high. So one has to devote enough time, enough discussion, one can select the required peripheral, required microcontroller properly. Okay. Now, this is just one of the AOCs, how this is configured. Okay. You can configure in different way, but in general, as you see, this is here we get a raw bus. Raw bus means unregulated bus, and which get DC-DC converter get the regulated bus, required regulated bus. So this is the main system and redundant system. It is used for one of the standard satellite. And this is one computer, this is another computer. All the sensor signals, they go to the both computers. If you can see, all they are interconnected. Okay. Then including the command. Command also goes to the both computer, but they are all decoded inside, which is meant for either computer one or computer two. That only will take it for granted. Similarly, about the actuators. Now, actuator sensors, you can give it to both system, but actuators you cannot give to both. No, one actuator can receive only one input. No, you cannot drive. Either you should have a different redundant actuators, which is very expensive in terms of weight, power, cost and everything. And what you have selected output from the computer is given to the required system. So that is why the proper redundancy, though it will have redundant, if you are not manage this thing properly, redundancy will not help you much. It can still fail. So if a computer one is selected for operation, then all the signal will go from here. Computer two is selected from operation, go from here. At the same time, when I select computer two, computer one should not interfere in the selection. So that kind of thing one has to carry out. And this is just say some representation of that. Okay. Yes. This gives a little bit more details. We started this onboard computer, one of our insight series. Initially, we felt it is based on 88 CMOS version of 8086 processor. So why I'm telling all those things depends. In the future, one has to decide about that one. See, one initially we thought minimum two processors are required to carry out all this computation. But over the period, we find that even one is sufficient to carry out the thing. So we have put a selector. Either you can select this and this provides this. So this provides essentially the redundancy of the controller in terms of memory, in terms of controller, processors, or any other things. Whereas these are all IOs. This large amount of IOs are used in onboard computer, and which are required for the different interfaces like digital interface, analog interface, reaction wheel, and so many other. Okay, some safety logic, telemetry, command, payload, magnetic torquer, and so many other things. So solar ray drive, thruster, LAN, and so many things are required. So in general, a computer, onboard computer, the computer part is very less, but large amount of hardware goes in this IOs. So one has to optimize this IOs quite a lot. We will come later. Anyway, time is there. So we will come later on this part, how to optimize this IOs. Okay. Anybody is having any question, then I can explain more. But I don't know whether you people are getting or not.
Sir, what if there was a virus?
Virus. See, normally, virus are refer for the ground system. Okay. Where such kind of operating systems are used, many people are using the system. And the software is put into a disk, which can be changed the program. But most of this our onboard computer, you cannot change the program. The program is hardwired inside the memory, program memory. So chances of virus are very, very less. So because of that reason, if your development tool, what you are going to use, they should be certified properly. Chances of virus should not be there. If virus enters there, then even the program, though it is put into the hardware, it may be a malfunction. Okay. So one has to take care. That's why for the commercial satellite or a standard satellite, we don't use any tool which is just like that available on the internet. They're all should be certified. And this is to take care about this kind of precautions, that virus should not be there. Because anything if you download from internet, sometime it works, sometime doesn't work. But when you are putting into the satellite, satellite has to work round the clock. Okay. Any outage or any time stoppage will have a severe problem. Imagine I'm using the onboard computer for our geosynchronous satellite. You are receiving a TV channel through geosynchronous satellite. Suppose the computer malfunctions. It is not able to control the attitude of the satellite. That means you will not able to receive the signal at the ground. Your TV will not function. So how much annoying will be there for the people? So one has to take care such kind of thing very properly. Okay?
Clear, sir.
Okay, these are all typical cards. Now, here why I wanted to show you, here the controller is just a small controller, but these, many of these drivers, they are put into a technology called the hybrid micro packaging. So, large amount of this thing, which each one of them required at least quarter card, that much, that we have put into roughly 1-inch by 1/2-inch package. So such kind of optimizations are required, which part to be done and which part can be optimized for that application. So HMC is one area where HMC means hybrid micro packaging, where large amount of circuit, particular driver circuit, one can put inside this device. And that saves the lot of area inside. There are particular for our this thing, I will not go too much detail. Many HMCs are developed for our this application. So that the overall weight we can reduce. See, earlier computer weight used to call typical number 27 kg. Now by doing all those things, we got 9 to 10 kg. So that order of magnitude improvement we get. Now, another thing, again, this is another kind of computer which is currently being used. Earlier I mentioned about 8086. Now this is another kind of advancement of the computer where the computational requirements are more. So 8086 was not able to match the requirement. So one has gone through another type of processor called the 1750 processor, which is one of the standard processor and which is being used. Rest all things are similar, either use HMC or FPGA or whatever maybe they're using. And this is a single processor because this itself was able to sufficiently carry out the work. This is one kind of thing processors we have. Yes. Further, like HMC, which integrates lot of this power devices. Similarly, nowadays that semiconductor technology has moved quite advanced stage. So what is happening in this semiconductor technologies? People use either FPGAs or ASICs. If you are making number of satellite, you can integrate large number of hardware into a single ASICs. So overall, we have designed five types of ASICs, which can replace a large amount of the hardware. Thus, reduce for 10 kg hardware to say 5 kg, 6 kg hardware. So that also helps quite a lot. So how do you reduce the hardware? One is using HMCs, other is using ASICs or using FPGAs. Okay, FPGA is another way of reducing the hardware. So this is also already I mentioned field FPGA means field programmable gate array micro packaging. Then some of the modular architectures one can use. And then once you integrate more and more, you essentially require a multi-layer PCBs. Then only you can achieve the required density in the PCBs. And that is very standard for any of the electronics application. I'll not get into. These are the some of the ASICs which was developed and was used in our system. Okay, similar way. Now you just see, this is much more dense card. There earlier card only few this HMCs and something were used. Here these are all ASICs. Whatever I'm talking, so they are all ASICs and large amount of functions are incorporated inside a single card. These are all standard things. And then now earlier there was a multiple packages. Now everything is put together and this computer serves for all IRS and inside series of spacecraft. Another advancement further at a sometime what happens, you have to also worry the obsolete of the component, because by that time you select the component and your satellite is launched, certain component get obsolete. It so happened here also. Initially what we use 1750 CPU particular type that called obsolete, and then we have to use another one 31750. But our design was such that simply by replacing that CPU we were able to compute all the requirements. So that one has to design in properly. This FDI logic earlier also was incorporated. I will come back little in later for these details. So this is what same thing. Yeah, this is what now FDI. So we'll take a 5-10 minutes break. 10 minutes break. What is the time now? 2:26. So we'll take 2:35. We'll come back. So we'll discuss this. This is important aspect which is not done in conventional computers and which is required to be done in satellite computers or missile computers and so on. Okay? Okay? 2:35?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Thank you. Okay, shall we start?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So now we will next half an hour, 45 minutes, we'll concentrate on some of the new features which you do not find in general computers. So this particular refers to both space satellite, spacecraft, missiles, and so many things. So they call the fault tolerant features. See that for improving the reliability, there are two ways. One is that use rugged components. Other is design such a way that it can tolerate some fault. It cannot tolerate all the fault, but to some extent it can tolerate the fault. And in general is considered a single point fault tolerant aspect. So there are multiple logics are used for fault tolerance. Some of them I will briefly describe. Fault detection and isolation, that will consider, that will take care about the any transient failures. Then for the spacecraft level, we consider as a safe mode, that also will come. There is something called the long pulse detection logic, that is also with respect to thruster firing. Then another features called the remote programming. In case any of the algorithms are wrong, we can remotely program the onboard computers. Then some of the EDCs, logic for correcting errors in the memories, and some majority voting logic. So some of these features are incorporated. Of course, one can think a lot more things to improve this fault tolerant feature, but these are the basic features. So as fault detection and isolation, this is specifically referred to the controller or processor, which some literature also refer as a watchdog timer. Means what it comes, I'm just reading the essential part. Watch it, what it comes, a cycle, software processor cycle supposed to be completed within, say, these are all real-time system. So there is a cycle time associated with each of these processors. So suppose your cycle has to be completed within, say, 10 milliseconds or 15 milliseconds. If it doesn't complete, that means some problems are there, either transient or permanent. So what it does, it will try to again run the software. At least consistently, we are getting this problem at least three times, multiple times, to avoid the spurious detection, multiple times. Mostly three times, then it resets the, now if it detected, it will try to do certain action on the processor equivalent to soft reset. So soft reset it will do. Then if continuously keeps on getting this kind of thing, it will do permanently declares the computer which is running is failed, whatever could be the reason, but it is failed, it is not performing, and change over automatically to the redundant system. So thus, it helps in overcoming some sort of fault. It may not be identify clearly what fault it is, but at least because that time when you are running the satellite, your objective is to how to complete the mission. So that is where it happens. So that is what, if the processor fails to execute the program consecutively three times, last sentence if you read, the FDI logic declare a failure and AOC then change over to the redundant system. Okay, so that is what the logic. Of course, this is just a representation of the FDI logic. It keeps on detecting and three times it detects. If continuously detected, continuously. It is not happened that two times it works, two times doesn't work, one time works, again two times doesn't work, then it will not detect. Okay, so continuously it detects three times, then it will declare as a failure and the changeover to the redundant system. Now another logic what we have here is called the safe mode logic. See, spacecraft particular, there are two primarily constraints. One is the power, other is the fuel. and thermal, of course, to that extent. So this safe mode logic has to be designed in such a condition, irrespective of whatever happened to the spacecraft, certain conditions are defined. The power should not fall below certain value. Temperature should not increase beyond some value. Fuel should not flow beyond some value, beyond some duration. Then it will trigger something called safe mode. So it puts the spacecraft into the safe mode and blocks the fuel so that it doesn't go waste, and also orient the spacecraft in such a way it generates enough power, and thereby it will keep the spacecraft in the safe condition. So that is called the safe mode logic. I'm not getting into too much detail of that, otherwise for each one of them require 1 hour lecture. So I'm just giving the idea, this is a safe mode logic which keeps the spacecraft under safe condition. So if you remember, I don't know to what extent you remember, when Mr. Malik was giving about the system engineering lectures, there he mentioned about the safe mode logic. What kind of safe mode? Under what condition the spacecraft is safe? So that one has to decide under that circumstances. Okay. So then you can realize, once you decide what is required to be safe, then you can decide what kind of, how to realize this logic. And this is some hardware logic, which I'll not get into that. Okay. There is something as multiple times safety has to be there, because for some time temperature goes little high or power shortage is there, it will still survive. But if fuel goes, it will continuously high, the spacecraft simply will tumble and it will lose the lock, and it is a dangerous situation. So there is another level of safety called the long pulse detection. Long pulse detection, here what it refers, normally that fuel thrusters, they are supposed to fire in order of some few milliseconds or something like that, tens of milliseconds. But by chance, because of some reason, it is continuously firing, then also it shuts off the fuel so that fuel will not be lost. Then you can analyze the condition, and then based on the situation, then you take the required decision. So this is another kind of logic what we have there. Okay, this is again the hardware realization, which right now I'm not getting into this one. This is called the remote programming. Now you develop certain algorithms, and you simulated also. One possibility is that we did some mistake at the ground in simulation. Then once the satellite launched, we can't do anything. So for that reason, we thought of putting a logic called a remote programming logic. Means some part of the program we can modify, so that it can carry out the work, whatever the mistake, it overcome the mistakes. That is one aspect. Other aspect is we should have, suppose there are certain components are failed, some sensors are failed, say for example, but your algorithm requiring that sensor, what alternative we can think of that time when the situation warrant, then you start thinking what alternative we can think. So we can modify your program such that it bypasses that condition and still carry out the job. It may not be that accurate as in the normal condition, but however, it can survive the mission. For this purpose, the program has to be stored into RAM. Okay, so that is what is required. RAM condition has to be, RAM capacity has to be built into the controllers or computers. Now another, which is a very century old, at least several decade old technique, is a EDEC, error detection and correction in memory. See, as we mentioned earlier, because of the radiation effect, some of the memory bits, they get upset. sometime some bit may get permanently stuck. So if I use this logic, we can tolerate to some extent the memory, either upset or memory stuck to a wrong value always. So there is a memory error. So it can detect two bits failure and it can correct one bit failure. So this is the logic what we have in EDAC, which is of course is a very standard use in earlier computers as well. When the memory are too much volatile to or too much susceptible for any of this noise or other conditions, temperature conditions. So such kind of thing we have used, I say this kind of logic built into that. There are chips are available which can provide the EDAC logic. So same thing can be used for that. Now, EDAC, yes, it can take care about certain things, but certain critical parameters of the spacecraft still we have to further take care. So what we do, such a critical parameter we store in multiple places, mostly three places, and take when I'm reading the parameter, we take the majority voting. Okay, and then we write after majority voting, we write those places. So in between, if those parameters are corrupted, if only one place it is corrupted, two places are correct, we get the correct value and then we can write the correct value there and read the correct data for your further operation. So this is called the majority voting. So now you can see how many level of fault tolerance you have here. So now you can probably realize we have a detection, fault detection and isolation at the processor level. We have a detection at the spacecraft level. Like whatever may be the condition, if a spacecraft fuel, power and temperatures are not within the specified limit or the sensor is not sensing the proper signal, it can detect as a safe mode. So, and additionally, fuel is a very prime concern for the spacecraft because once it goes, nothing can be done. So another LPD, long pulse detection logic, then algorithmic failures, one can take care using remote programming. Further, some of the radiation related thing, upsets, you can take care by error detection and correction logic. In additionally, some of the memory or radiation or third aspect for the critical parameters, we can take care about the majority voting logic. We cannot put everywhere majority voting logic because the amount of overhead on the controller will be very, very high. So we put only specific cases. Okay. So you understand now why we incorporate this some of the failure detection logics. Okay. This gives only just anyway, I will send these notes to you people. So you can go through, but essentially I give this idea that we have to take care about the multiple level of failure detection and masking of the fault so that your mission is survive. It is not just like when we use our laptop, one virus enters, it simply hangs. We can't afford to have such situation. Ne? Satellite. Now, another simple part. This is a simple part. Software. Now, software can be complex, software can be simple. Depends how you design. The basic thumb rule in the software, a good software, it should be highly reliable. Okay. So, because in general it is not repairable, but however, because of remote programming, we still can do this one. But if possible to avoid, we should avoid. and the whole mission is uninterrupted and the involve large cost. Another software attributes which when we design is adaptable to different mission. It should not happen that we design one spacecraft, for the next spacecraft again we have to redesign the complete software. It's not. 90% of the software should be similar. 10% of the mission specific software which can robust means essentially the different way of telling reliable. Okay, so this is a robust system. Testability, this is another very very important part. We design this software which is very complex, but we can't test all the conditions, then it is not acceptable. So always we design the software simplest possible way. No tricks are played for onboard computing environment. Simple, so that anybody can understand, anybody can design the test cases, and all the conditions we can simulate and test it. Then some cases is the execution efficiency. It so happen certain IO, our experience shows certain IO operations we are able to, if we are doing in high level language, it takes a lot of time in terms of execution time. So sometimes if the provision exists in the system, you can combine assembly language with the assembly level language with the high level language, which can carry out the required function. But not everything should be in assembly language, because otherwise again the development time will be very less. Memory efficiency, in general it should occupy less memory. Well proven development tool, that already we discussed on the selection of the processor. Because of that consideration, because of the various literature available, we use in some of the satellite ADA language as a, which is considered as a well proven and very strong type language, and chances of mistakes are much much less. But however, availability of ADA programmer is very less, so nowadays most of the people are concentrating on C language. So of course that depends upon what is the resources available to you. As far as the development methodology is concerned, it is like a typical software flow. Spacecraft requirement, from the spacecraft requirement we come out with a control system requirement, then carry out the control design and simulation on the high level computer. That is where the test cases we create. Then from that we give the software requirements. Then this each stage we require to have a review. Then we carry out the initial design. And just 1 minute, I will call you Ajay. I'm in meeting. I'll just call you another half an hour. Okay, then preliminary design review, detailed design, these are all typical software thing. But what is more interest is here, every stage we have to have a design review. Okay, so that is where one has to carry out the software development method. This is another way of just representing, like when we find some error, where I should go and what is corresponding to what and so on. We'll not get into too much detail of that. Now coming to a more practical aspect, that is what I talk very general. When we try to develop this software, it's a real-time thing. There are plenty of real-time operating systems are available. But based on our experience, based on our requirement, we find that those operating system capabilities are not much useful. That is one aspect. Second thing, if most of the ground system, they use interrupts, and we avoided using interrupt, because of the reason, the testability. The testability will be poor if it is an interrupt is there. So based on that, a very simple scheduler was developed, which can be understood by anyone. Like if you have a starting initialization, then there is a cyclic program. This goes cyclic program. Whatever resident program is there, it keeps on doing continuously. Only thing is that, as we mentioned, if there is a requirement for remote programming or program to be executed remote using run, so that kind of something we can make use of here. So that problem happened. And whole software, it runs 8 minor cycles of 4 milliseconds each. Of course, that will vary depending upon the requirement. There is nothing like very specific. There is a major cycle, 32. There is a certain computation. You can do a 32, but they are not required to do a 32. So they can go for the 1 second or multiple of 32 millisecond timing. So such kind of the simplest possible software architecture one has to develop. This is the same thing we have given here. We'll skip that one. Okay. There are plenty of software we use. Some of them are just for you to just understand what the OVC, attitudinal orbit control software, are. Attitude error processing software, attitude control software, control algorithm, control of actuator, health monitoring, that is telemetry, commanding, mission specific processing, fault tolerance aspect, and some subsystem interface protocols. So such kind of things are part of the software. Many of these modules, like they are classified in terms of some pre-processing module, post-processing module, and so on. But they are like for the different modes of the spacecraft operations, and then controllers, then post-processing, certain propagation, certain things have to run continuously. We have to judge very judiciously here what has to run continuously, what has to run periodically, so that we can say optimize the overall execution time. So many are there, depending upon the kind of thing. Now you just see the operating system, what is comes here is a simple round robin scheduling. It starts here. This is one minor cycle, does certain things, which another minor cycle, they form the major cycles. So that is what the simple operating system we have developed ourselves. Either one can use the standard operating system, but the overhead created by the standard real-time operating system is very high, and that because of that reason will not get into that part. And this is some of the development environment very specific to the processor. Now that is for the onboard systems. So here, for testing of this AOC, we require a specific equipment called the test systems. So that is what the one has to develop, the required test system. I will not get into the details of this one. Yeah, this is what somewhere I mentioned, that test sequences, initial bench test, that is most of the time goes here, then pre-vibration test, post-vibration test, then thermovac test, repeated thermovac test, and so on. But these sequences again depends upon what the QA guidelines are there. That is where one has to follow. This, if you see right side, there is a vibration table where the package is mounted on the vibration table and vibrated on different axes so that carry out the job. This is a thermovac chamber where we can insert that package, either individual package level or the whole satellite level. This, of course, picture says for the whole satellite itself, enter there, and that we carry out the thing. So this is also another type of thing where I think the thermal person was talking, no? Thermal balance test and something of that sort of thing. So that probably is another way of testing. Okay, so these are the general things, whatever we talked. Some of the things which we planned long back, now they are really being used in the practice. One is called the integrated. Now the question comes, all the time we are telling we should minimize the hardware, we should minimize the hardware. Now why we should have a separate? If you see here, I'll go through initial slide. Where is that interface slide? 1 minute. This one. See, so several things are there. Now, if I can combine all the computational requirement to a single one, that will be more efficient. And that is where the efforts are now made and it was realized in practice. And that's the integrated system called the bus management unit. It's some name given, or you can call as an integrated computing system and so on. So there, command function, telemetry function, attitudinal orbit control function, temperature sensor electronics, everything is joined together in highly integrated system called the bus management. And this is also the different kind of interfaces, but their interfaces are mentioned only on standard bus, that is the MIL 1553 bus. So that is where all the subsystems are coupled. Something which you cannot couple is like a thruster, which is required a high power driver, torquer and heaters and so on. They are directly driven. Otherwise, all the subsystem, they are driven by MIL 1553. Advantage comes. First thing, the chances of mistakes are very less and everybody understands the standard protocol, and integration of such kind of unit, once it comes at the spacecraft level, it becomes very, very easy. This is similar configuration, but only thing, some of the IOs are changed because of the different requirements, and that is where we incorporated. So these are all details of the hardware for particular CARTOSAT 2 satellites and so on. So this is what I mentioned to you, that attitude control, command processing, telemetry, housekeeping, onboard storage. Many times we require to store the data on board, sensor processing, thermal management, power management, MIL 1553 bus protocol, autonomous operation. See, nowadays there is a large demand. That requirement on the ground should be very, very less. We should concentrate mostly by the onboard autonomy. So that is where a lot of operations are now incorporated. Anyway, this is our, one can use lot of advanced tools, object oriented, which is, of course, this is little old slide. So now everybody uses that one, and UML based cache tools are the computer aided software environment or something tools. They are used for development essentially to minimize the hardware, minimize the mistakes. Language, anyway, these are all already mentioned, ADA, and lot of ASICs, FPGAs and HMCs are used to reduce the hardware. And this is some sort of package. It was that time artistic view, but it was realized, it is not remaining as an artistic view. It was realized in practice. There are different kind of HMCs. See, if I put so many devices on the PCB, it required very large amount of, whereas in 1 square inch, I can put so many devices if I'm using HMCs. There are different type of HMCs we use. Then different kind of, no, not different kind. These are all a configuration of MIL 1553 bus, which is used for star sensor, for GPS system, for BDH, and so many other things. And this is some sort of configuration of MIL 1553. Now, See, always whenever you change the system, there will be other reluctance. But nowadays, everybody is accepted for Mill 1553. Even the actuators like wheels, they are going for the Mill 1553 type of thing. Okay. So that one can use. One can use such kind of configuration, whether it's a Mill 1553 or there is a progress regarding equivalent fiber optics bus. If you want a larger bandwidth, Mill 1553 is a limited bandwidth bus. So such kind of thing one can do. There are certain test setups required for everything. That is, this is for the Mill 1553 bus test setup. There are different components for this thing and that probably. This is another way. Suppose still your power increase requirement, like nowadays they call the multi-core processor. Okay. When number of core processors are more. So here the 4 CPU configuration was developed so that one can use for more computational aspect, particular like human space mission and so, where the requirements will be very, very large. So one can use such kind of thing. So this is all the facilities what we have here. Space chamber, this was there. They are all, see, old one, but now presently they keep on augmenting. Vibration facilities, thermovac chambers, different. Here we carry out based on this individual level, package level. Here we carry out spacecraft level and so on. There is another thing. To prove a control algorithms at the ground, we have to simulate the correct condition. So for this purpose, a 3-axis servo table is used, where the sensors are mounted on this table, and all the actuators are connected in the hardware, and that is called the hardware in loop simulation. And our experience shows, if we carry out such kind of simulation correctly, then chances of mistake in onboard the satellite will be very, very less. So that is what, this is an integration clean room where the satellite is mounted. There is some facility called the acoustic facilities, where satellite is not only vibration. See, it's because of the large sound also that create the vibration and the component fails. So such kind of thing also, facilities are also there, managed to go through. There are several satellites, and this is very, very small number. Now plenty of satellites are there, both IRS and Indian, remote sensing, as well as astronomical applications and so on. Yeah, this is a very old picture. Can anybody identify what it is?
Sir, Vidhan Chauda.
Yeah. You're able to written there, or you identify yourself?
Identified, sir.
Yes. So this is Vidhan Chauda. This is High Court. Okay. And then peripheral. Of course, nowadays, if you go and see, probably whole thing might have changed. This is another one. What you can see? This is that
earlier time, bus stand
was there. There was always buses, they were parked in some sort of arc type of thing, you know. So that kind of bus stand. Of course, here this area is now changed quite a lot, but this remains same. So this was one of this thing. This is Bangalore Airport, which was airport at the HAL. This was not the international airport. That time that was the airport district one can use. And this is New Delhi. This area is a Connaught. Those who have visited New Delhi, they will be knowing Connaught Place, India Gate, Rajpath, President Place, and so many things are there. So now, why I want to show this thing? If you want to observe such kind of thing, you require a better and better satellite capability in terms of the accuracy, vibration, accuracy and jitters. Jitters means the stability of the camera. So such kind of thing, you require more and more algorithms. So what we do nowadays, developing the algorithm for the new satellite, commercial satellite, takes a lot of time. University professors, suppose they have a very good ideas of algorithm, that should be, nobody will provide them big platform. So they can launch a small satellite and test their algorithm. Once this algorithm is proven, then they can go for the higher satellite. So that is where advantage of this university satellite. Apart from that, the students also will get a lot of ideas which are not being done at normal project level. So that is one ideas are there. This is just a summary, whatever the things we have developed. So this is what with respect to this one. Now, if you have any question, we can, we have still 5-10 minutes time. We will deal with that one. Any general question about the computer? Because the next topic I am going to take on the reliability aspect, that is little away from this one, but you will realize that whatever we have learned so far, everything is mapped to those reliability. And finally, I will take some couple of lectures on how the PiSat was developed, and we will try to map all those requirements to whatever we have learned so far. So that is what the thing is. So any question, anybody?
Sir, I have a question regarding notes, sir.
Regarding what?
Notes.
Notes?
Yes, sir.
Hmm.
Sir, we didn't receive the notes, sir, from various lecturers.
I gave to Karthik, no? Everything.
No, sir. Karthik, sir, didn't receive the notes, sir.
This PPTs?
Yes, sir.
I will send. I have everything. I will send to Karthik because he is coordinating. Today itself, whatever we have, this one, we will send it. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Yeah, anybody? Today itself will send. You have not received even single. Because I remember.
We have received some, sir, for first test, sir. Third.
Okay. If you have a, right now itself, I will send it, some of them, to Karthik. So that at least she will know. 1 minute, huh? Just first let me go out of this thing. Stop presenting. Okay. So then, I don't know where it is gone. 1 minute, huh? Just, I have a notes of all. What I will do, because each of this PPT is very large size, it may not go. I will zip it and by today I will send it.
Okay, sir. We have exam on 17th, 18th and 19th, sir.
17th. And today itself I will send.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So that is what. If you want, some of your mail is there. I can send to one of you and you can circulate also in case it takes some time.
Yes, sir. You can give to my email, sir.
What is your email? Bhuvan Raj.
Anirudh, sir. Anirudh.
I have sent some time or?
You have sent an email to me, sir, regarding one PPT. ANIDPZ999@gmail.com.
1 minute. Can you slowly tell?
ANI, sir.
ANI.
Yes, sir.
DBZ. ANIDPZ999.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'll send it.
Yes, sir.
Let me just see if I can attach right now itself. Right, just because sometime I will have another meeting. So, and I... if it is attach... which you required immediately, you tell me, if that I will send it, so that.
Sir, telemetry, tracking command, communication, okay, structures. Right. Yes, sir.
Right now. But please make sure that you send it to everyone. Okay.
Yes, sir.
This is structure. Attach a copy. Then further, you want thermal. Huh?
Sir, we have thermal already, sir. We don't have telemetry tracking command and communication and power system.
Okay. Telemetry. I will again send it to our Karthik, but additionally I am sending to you. Okay. Communication. So this is over command telemetry and structure.
Yes, sir.
Power, that is sir. Power. No, this will go in the next slide.
Okay,
just
sir.
See.
Yes, sent it, sir.
No, power is still I have to send.
Yes, sir.
Just because it was not coming. Yeah.
Sir, you can send additional email, sir. Another email.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing.
Yes, sir.
Let it go. This is gone. Now, you want power. Attach a copy. And today's lecture also, today and last lecture. That
yes,
also.
Sir. Yes, sir.
That also I am attaching.
Yes, sir.
And all those things I will combine and then send it to.
Okay, sir.
This one. Just see whether you're receiving or not. But you please make sure that. Everybody should get it.
Yes, sir. I'll do it, sir. I got the mail, sir.
1 minute. I have one onboard computer. No, this will not come. Or today, I think that I have to zip it.
Sir, I received the mail, sir.
I send another one also.
Okay, sir, I'll check.
Now, what is remaining is today's one. Today and that last one.
Yes, sir, and power system.
Power system I have sent now. Just see.
Okay, sir.
Just see, check up. Coming?
Received, sir. Received.
Yeah, just wait a minute. I will send this also. I'll
okay,
generate
sir.
PDF and then send it so that at least you will. PDF. Because if this is there, I don't want you to wait for anything. Of course, in second test, we are not covering. One minute, just. Anyway, I will send everything once again. Anirudh. Thermal you have already?
Sir, we have thermal already, sir.
Okay. So I'm sending this now onboard computer also.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So far now everything is there. Just you please confirm. In case if you do not have, let me know.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Bye. So Thursday we'll again meet and we'll discuss. Thursday you have class or not?
We have, sir. Afternoon. Morning.
So when is your exam?
Sir, next Wednesday. Next Wednesday, sir.
Okay. So Thursday we'll start based on your and then how many classes we have now? Still we have plenty?
Sir, November by November end last working day, sir.
Okay, then it's okay. Sufficient classes are there. So in cases, suppose you people want the preparation for Wednesday, I can skip. That's okay.
Yes, sir.
I can take. So this Thursday we'll have class. Next Monday we can leave it. So that Wednesday you have. Correct?
Yes, sir. Next Wednesday you have class, sir.
Wednesday you have exam.
Yes, sir. Next Wednesday.
Okay, fine. So that is okay then. Then we'll see. We'll decide on Thursday.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks. Okay. Yeah. Now.
Sir, I received the mail of OBC, sir.
Yes. So now this completes everything.
Yes, sir.
Good. Okay. Prepare well.
Thank you, sir.